Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Rahila Zafar, Saad Al-Sharahi, Yasmin Al-Tawajri, and Mohammed Sheikh.
Can everyone hear me? Hi. So let me make sure that this works. So I remember November 2015. I had just come back from a really long trip in the Middle East, where I visited Saudi Arabia, Jordan, the UAE, Kuwait, Palestine. And I had the opportunity to meet Joseph Lubin, the founder of Consensus, for the first time. And in the conversation that we had, I had mentioned Vision 2030 in Saudi Arabia and how something like Ethereum and blockchain would completely transform the region, and not only that, but the Middle East and a country like Saudi Arabia would play a leading role in terms of accelerating the technology. And I think before we begin, I just wanted to let you know why I think the kingdom is so exciting. So Saudi Arabia is the largest economy in the Middle East. The population is 30 million and the majority is under the age of 30. On top of that, the majority of STEM majors are women, and half of computer science majors in the country are women. And for the past decade, there have been hundreds of thousands of Saudis, men and women, that have been fully funded to study all across the world, while Saudi Arabia has been developing a world-class university system and also tech ecosystem. So our panelists here are going to tell us a little bit more about Vision 2030, but it is one of the most aggressive plans in the world, if not the most, in terms of transforming Saudi Arabia from an oil economy into one of the most futuristic economies in the world. And it has very aggressive plans in terms of women's participation in the labor force as well. And one of the major projects in Saudi Arabia is NEOM, and it's a $500 billion project that is going to be a city that is 33 times the size of New York. And they estimate that there's going to be more robots than people. It's going to be entirely run by futuristic technology. And also, it's going to be an 8-hour flight from 70% of the world, and it borders Europe, Asia, and Africa. So Saudi Arabia has a public investment fund and is investing $2 trillion towards innovation. And some of that money has been partnering with entities such as SoftBank to create the world's largest tech fund. And that is the Crown Prince of Saudi Arabia, Mohammed bin Salman. And that's Mohammed bin Salman with one of the co-founders of Google. And MISC is the nonprofit of the Crown Prince that is really committed towards creating a tech ecosystem in the kingdom, particularly targeting youth. So Google has committed towards working with 100,000 Saudi students. And in January, the Saudi government and MISC invited Joe Lubin to come and speak. So it was amazing to see young Saudi men and women come to see Joe speak, and they talked about how they flew from all over the country that he was speaking at MISC. And Sheikh sitting next to me, where it's largest telco in the region. And Saud was just telling me that he's really proud that STC has overtaken Emirates to be the biggest brand in the Arab world as well. So it's been really exciting to also see changes happening so rapidly with women in the kingdom. In terms of, in 2015, women were given the right to vote. At every conference that you go to in the Arab world, even in places like Saudi Arabia, there are half the room is full of women at tech conferences, at business conferences, at Saudi Aramco, in aviation, at the Saudi Stock Exchange, in every single sector of Saudi society, there are women in leadership roles. And I think the first question is for Yasmin. This woman in black is a friend of yours. And tell us about this picture, and also tell us about how a Saudi woman epidemiologist became interested in blockchain.
Thank you, Rahila. This is a very important picture, as it is a very good example of how women have really progressed in Saudi Arabia. That's a picture of Dr. Tamadar Ramah, who's the Deputy Minister of Labor in Saudi Arabia. And here is a picture of her visiting one of the northern regions in Saudi Arabia, and all the men in the room are there for an official visit with her. And she was telling us after her visit that she felt completely at ease. Everyone was welcoming, and they're willing to encourage more women to come and work in these positions. There was no problems or resistance, on the contrary. As for me, being an epidemiologist, working at a tertiary care hospital, I work at the King Faisal Specialist Hospital and Research Center. We have, because of the nature of what we do in research, mm-hmm. we collect data through our research. So whether it's data from clinical trials or clinical research or community mm-hmm. population-based research or surveys, mm-hmm. We have a lot of data stored in our department. Basically data is our medium, because in epidemiology it's the quantitative field of public mm-hmm. health. And so I got interested in blockchain when I learned about its potential as a very important public health tool, because when you put massive amounts of health data on the blockchain, mm-hmm. over time it resembles a massive longitudinal study, mm-hmm. which allows us to longitudinally assess how diseases occur, what are the risk factors, what are the things that control disease, and eventually that will help us in disease prevention and promotion and that kind of thing. So I got interested in blockchain for that reason. And right now we're doing a national survey for mental health, which is, as probably a lot of you know, is one of the global epidemics in the world. And so we've done a survey that collects 14,000 variables from individuals, and we usually just analyze the results, come up with the statistics, publish the results in journals, maybe write a technical report. But now we know that there's a huge opportunity to dive deeper into the data using emerging technology, whether it's machine learning or AI or blockchain. So we're gonna start moving in that direction. And this is a really exciting time for us.
Thank you, Yasmin. And just so you guys know, Saudi Arabia never had these nationwide surveys in mental health in a lot of areas, and Yasmin has led them. I think the first nationwide surveys like these, not just in Saudi Arabia, but in much of the Arab world. So Saud, tell us more about Vision 2030 and how blockchain can play a role in implementing its objectives.
Well, In Saudi Arabia, I mean, we've been really fortunate to have a great leadership within the kingdom that sets the vision. Vision 2030 is a very ambitious yet achievable kind of roadmap, or if you will, a blueprint for the whole country to move. And it's built on three main themes, and there are multiple programs under Vision 2030. And digitization has been placed. So now, if we think about digitization, new and latest technologies are very important for us, such as blockchain, where there are some features in blockchain what makes it even more interesting, which is the transparency, mm-hmm. security, the reliability, and also the security, reliability, and transparency as well. So this sets blockchain as one of the very promising, technologies for Saudi Arabia, and this will set us in a future-proof kind of technology that will help us in achieving our goals.
And to follow up on that, how does STC see themselves as a facilitator, I think especially from the perspective of a tel cloud provider, to jumpstart the ecosystem?
Okay. Well, telcos usually have a different place. So if we take a look at the value chain of any technology in general, so we've been well known in networking, which is, this is our bread and butter. Mm-hmm. And then many telcos are providing also data center kind of services, such as cloud services. So in this way, it's a typical play for us where any company or any enterprise or government that would like to try out blockchain, they can put it on top of that. However, an STC would like even to take this even further. What we want to do is actually build like blockchain as a service to be able to lower the barrier to entry to anyone who wants to try blockchain, as well as even developing some kind of application specific for enterprises, and also whether they are custom-based for government entities or something which is going to be more generic that can serve the whole SME market, for example.
We were just talking about the data consumption in Saudi Arabia. For those of you that don't know, it's the highest penetration per capita of Twitter and YouTube, and yeah. I think the highest smartphone penetration as well in the world. So
it's a lot of data.
So Mo, consensus does work all over the world. What makes Saudi Arabia so exciting, not just for consensus, but in terms of accelerating blockchain technology?
Sure. So that's a great question. When you think about consensus, obviously we're leading efforts for blockchain implementation, but we're also have a strong ethos attached to having participants be a part of this technology. Now, if you look at what has happened in early 2000s, late 90s, with the dot-com boom, that led to developed economies really being at the forefront of being able to take advantage of that. That meant extreme, that meant real good growth of GDP for obviously developed countries, especially the U.S. When you think about what our ethos is again and how we want to apply that across the world, we look at countries that have been classified perhaps as emerging markets that are sometimes second movers, right? So if we look at Saudi, if we look at other countries across the world, we want to make sure that they don't get, they're not the slow movers as they once were, right? So here's an opportunity for us to help participate in the global economy and move that forward. For consensus and for myself specifically, I lived in the region and following things like Vision 2030, what particularly got us excited is the youth in Saudi Arabia. So I believe 20% of 30 million people in Saudi Arabia are within the ages of 15 to 24. And not only in Saudi Arabia, but again, in a lot of these emerging economies, these youth, this population of youth will play a significant role in the development of the world. And if you pair these excited youth that want to work, pair new technology, it makes it a perfect opportunity for countries to sort of participate in this new space. So that's one of the reasons we've decided to pursue Saudi Arabia. Obviously, it helped to have someone like STC in our corner and the headwinds, well, not the headwinds, but being able to sort of follow through the evolution that's taking place in the country, pairing that together makes it a perfect recipe for adoption of this new technology as well.
So Yasmin, you introduced us to a woman named Dima from MISC that helped facilitate Consensus's trip to Saudi Arabia back in January. Can you tell us more about women that are helping to drive the creation of a startup and tech ecosystem in the kingdom?
So Saudi Arabia is undergoing a transformation. And because of that, every capable person in the Saudi population needs to step up and to contribute. So marginalizing any particular demographic is out of the question. Regardless whether you're male or female, everyone's going to be contributing to the new changes that are happening, whether they're in technology or in other aspects that are changing. We see now a lot of women that are leading technology in Saudi Arabia. Dima Al-Yahya is one of the well-known established names. She, I actually just got a text message from her before we came on stage. She's leading digitization in the government. We also have now the new authority for cybersecurity is led by the CEO is Nofer Rakan. We have faculties, complete faculties of in the universities of computer sciences and sciences that are graduating very talented technologists that are female. And so I think there is the pipeline for leadership for women in this sector is there and very well developed, and I think we're going to see more and more of them coming into this space. And I think especially for blockchain, well, in for technology, I think in general only 5 to 7% are females. And now since blockchain is evolving, I think this is a great opportunity to involve more women in the field, so that we can have it will grow and be a balanced industry, especially in growing economies like in Saudi Arabia.
Well, you've been a great advocate in helping that happen, so thank you.
Thanks.
Saud, how do you think about key sectors and use cases, and what are some that are your favorite and why?
Oh, that's a tough one. When it comes to the sectors, I mean, we typically do an assessment where one of the key important factors is actually whether it has its strategic fit within the national agenda or the corporate itself strategy. The second part comes to the readiness. There are many corporates and sectors that they are not ready for blockchain now. And some of them even they are misunderstanding what blockchain can do for them. And this can create a challenge for us. And once this gets cleared up, I think this is one of the important factors. And last but not least is the impact. How impactful this use case is gonna be. Because we have limited resources and we want to make sure that we create the major impact with someone who is really knowing exactly what they want to do, and it fits within the strategy of either the national agenda or the company itself. Now, once we have this good mix, I believe we can create a very good use case that can be provided. When it comes to the use cases, I mean, when it comes to blockchain, when I go there, it's like you're a kid in, let's say, a theme park or Toys R Us. Mm-hmm. You're just looking at all those toys, I just don't know which one you should take. Mm-hmm. So they're mostly exciting. However, being from a telco background, there is something that I've been passionate about for a very long time, which is IoT. So it's not only blockchain per se, but I want to imagine, and I encourage everyone to imagine what the future would look like if we have blockchain, IoT, the edge computing, machine learning. If you mesh them all together, what's going to happen? So you have those IoT devices which are being identified and securely transmitting data over blockchain network. They are decentralized and they have edge computing where they can even act as nodes, mm-hmm. and they can even learn as they go. So just imagine how this would look like. So it's something that's interesting and to think about and really looking forward to applications that will apply all of them together.
Thank you.
Can I add to that one?
What?
Can I add to that one?
Yeah, please.
Cool. So just to bring a little color there, I think Sao mentioned a very interesting process, right? Being able to understand the technology's implications across various industries, then overlay that with, you know, where the government and the nation's sort of needs are. And that's exactly what we did when we came down to Saudi a couple months ago. You know, went through this session where, you know, we literally walked through all the implications that are taking place across various industries, narrowed in on a few use cases that we liked, and then going from those use cases, figuring out which ones make sense to deploy today, keeping in mind which use cases we can evolve to and help support in the future as well. One example that comes to mind is work that we did in Dubai, actually, for land titling. Mm-hmm. Obviously, land title being a very easy use case to sort of think about, being able to transfer titles from party A to party B on chain, making it sort of a trustless system, a much more efficient system. That was one of the use cases we honed in on. One of the use cases that I personally really like, maybe that's where you start. That's the cornerstone. But what can evolve to is very interesting business models, as you mentioned. One of those business models could be fractional ownership of real estate, which would allow, you know, the 30 million people in the kingdom to potentially own a piece of real estate rather than, you know, just being a passive tenant. But these are sort of the things that we need to keep in mind, you know, when we think about implementation of various use cases, not only in the kingdom, but across various countries. You know, where do you start today versus where you can go tomorrow? Where are the factors that kind of lend yourself to getting up and running in early days and then sort of getting the facilitation from government entities, from the public and the market to get you to where you need to be tomorrow?
Yeah.
I guess this question's for all of you. How can the Kingdom of Saudi Arabia position themselves in terms of being a leader in developing the blockchain ecosystem?
I can start that one. So I think going through that exercise that Saud mentioned is a great place to start. But in order to become a leader, you really have to have support from multiple fronts. You need not only buy-in from an entity like STC, which we believe is a great enabler of the technology, love to hear your thoughts there, but from our end, having the support of multiple enablers, but participants, whether they're private or public parties, that help take some of these use cases forward. We realize, you know, we are in early days, right? So you'll have challenges with regulation. Mm-hmm. There'll be this education curve that you want to ramp up on. Being able to, you know, educate government parties or public parties and helping them understand, you know, how they can benefit from the process improvement today is definitely a starting point. So education, both public and private parties. But then you need, from that education, should spur coordination and buy-in. Mm-hmm. You know, instead of having pushback, there should be an agreement to test things out. And what really excites us about in Saudi Arabia is we have that government support and we have that private sector support.
Yeah.
So now it then comes to us to identify these use cases and actually go out to the market and deploy them.
I totally agree. I mean, we are going through like an awareness exercise where we have to promote blockchain and make sure that everyone or most of them or the majority knows exactly what it is and how it is used, because this is one of the misconceptions that are available at the moment. And the second part is related to the what you said when you said that everyone has to be involved, and this is something that we are doing right now. And in addition to having more of a minimum viable product, that you want to start something that you might not know what it's going to look like at the end, but start somewhere, go having this ecosystem behind you and starting something from the ground up, and then you can leave it evolve with the community.
And you mentioned that STC is working with Neom. And yeah. What advantages do you think that futuristic cities like that, and Neom is going to have their own law and legal system that's separate from the kingdom? How do you see that potentially helping accelerate the technology and experiments and pushing things forward?
Okay. Well, when it comes to Neom, it's one of the major and very ambitious projects in Saudi. And this is one of the targets for Saudi Telecom. Saudi Telecom is the incumbent and it's the largest telco in Saudi. So we want to make sure that we leverage the strengths that we have in Saudi to be able to deliver and accelerate the deployment of Neom. So our positioning is mainly at the moment in the infrastructure basis and what kind of things that we can do together from now to be able to plan forward in the future.
Mm-hmm. If I could add to okay. that one. So I think one of the stats that you mentioned was there'll be more robots than humans in that city. Was that true?
Yeah.
to me, that's kind of crazy. But when I look at it from an economic impact perspective, smart cities have a huge opportunity, especially in Saudi Arabia. One of the World Economic Forum stats that gets thrown out is for every 10% increase in mobile penetration, mm-hmm. there's a corresponding 1.7% increase in GDP. Mm-hmm. So if you take that and apply that to Saudi, a population of 30 million producing roughly $600 billion worth of GDP, if you want to diversify away from oil, mm-hmm. you're probably going to look at new industries, technology being one of them, and then blockchain being another. So, I mean, this is, again, another opportunity if you are able to increase penetration into a smart city like Neom, create new jobs, you can have a pretty significant impact. And if you back into the math, that's roughly $20 billion of GDP coming from non-oil generated income, mm-hmm. Which is something that's exciting for that country, for the kingdom.
And Saud and Yasmin, and as Saudi Arabia, like over the past decade, is making this transition out of becoming an oil economy, you're seeing a number of entrepreneurs, both young men and women. And if you guys can kind of let the audience know what it's been like in terms of, you know, being part of the kingdom, developing this amazing tech ecosystem, what the state of it is, what you think can be done to help accelerate it, how an entity like STC, how do you feel like you've been supporting that?
I can take a try to answer that question. From the perspective of women who yeah. are entrepreneurs in Saudi Arabia, I think it's now reached 40% of entrepreneurs in Saudi Arabia are females. These are the
wow.
official statistics. But there's a unofficial economy that is created by cottage industries, women who are selling things from their homes, and it's being marketed on Instagram, mm-hmm. and they've got their own, they've even developed a very well organized logistics mm-hmm. System, and so there's this Instagram economy that's a little bit more developed in Saudi, in our part of the world, even maybe more than it does exist here.
That's true. I think I had featured Yasmin in a book called Arab Women Rising. And after it came out, Facebook contacted me, and they said that they had no idea that there were so many Arab women starting businesses on Instagram, and also that so many of these businesses have gone from Instagram businesses to actually storefronts. So I think that was something interesting.
Exactly.
Yeah.
So here we have an opportunity now where technology can harness this kind of entrepreneurial spirit and allow these women to become official. Like imagine a woman who lives in a village and she doesn't have access to a bank account or she doesn't have an official ID. Through technology, for example, blockchain, Uport, they can help these women have money transactions and their identity. They can own their identity online. So it's I think through technology that we can develop a lot. We'll see a lot of changes in this area.
Yeah, I think, I mean, it's interesting when you mentioned the, I would say, the monetary piece or the financial aspect. I mean, 3 days ago, the government just announced the financial sector development program, which is part of the Vision 2030. And as part of that program, there is an intention to increase the number of digital payments 38% within the next coming 3 years. I mean, it's a massive, I would say, growth that is required. The other part is related to fintech. We are planning to have at least 3 fintech companies within the next 3 years. It's part of the national agenda for the country. So promoting startups to be able to do this, I mean, it's something that is, there is no better time than now in Saudi to be in the, I would say, to start your business. The facilitation, whatever is happening today, everything is to promote those businesses. When it comes to STC, we have Inspire You, which is a part of STC, which is it's like an incubation piece within STC. We have STV, which is STC Ventures, which has the capital of $500 million. Where we are investing in the companies and startups to just give them, I mean, funds, but it's purely from investment point of view.
Wow, do you have anything to add?
I think those guys covered it pretty well there.
So we're taking questions from the audience as well. So feel free to line up if you have any. I think the other question that I had for you guys is we hear about really significant cultural shifts happening in terms of movie theaters and Black Panther and the entertainment cities and all of that. If you could kind of tell us more about some of the significant cultural shifts that have happened and are going to be happening.
Well, when it comes to culture and entertainment, historically, we live in a region that has very rich history of culture, and but for the past maybe 3 decades since the 70s, almost like there was a pause button on entertainment and culture or cultural events. So part of the Vision 2030 mandate is to develop that sector and provide these types of experiences for people in Saudi Arabia. So the General Entertainment Authority has been very active in that aspect. Now we have the General Cultural Authority. They're also developing visual and so many different types, all the different types of arts and cultures. And one of the programs of Vision 2030 is called the Quality of Life Program. And it's really interesting because what it's trying to do is to improve the quality of life of people that are living in the cities. They have a very ambitious but achievable aim of trying to be ranked among the top 100 cities around the world. And to do that, they have to focus on cultural institutions, entertainment, athletics, health, as well as logistics and transport. So, and that's sort of like a cross-sectoral, multi-sectoral type of plan. But they've been very actively pursuing the goals of this program, and I think we're going to see some changes very, very soon.
Yeah.
Do you have anything to add?
No.
I can add to that one.
Yeah.
So I grew up here, right here in Brooklyn, in this part called Brighton Beach. It's a Russian, predominantly Jewish neighborhood, actually, funny enough. And spending my entire life here, I actually never to go out and work in the Middle East. And for me, looking at it from the contrasting view that I had here, I was actually a bit nervous. I wasn't sure what the uncertainties of the Middle East would bring. But being able to spend time in Riyadh, in Dammam, and in Saudi Arabia in general was actually very exciting for me, because a lot of some of the misconceptions that I had from things that I had read, folks that had told me stories were actually pretty wrong. And to me, it was the youth that actually got me excited the most. When I look at culture, no offense to the old people, but I don't really look at them. I look at what the youth are going to be. So to see their kind of involvement in our side of the world, for me was, I was shocked, and I was very excited. When you go back to the Cultural Revolution, it's for me interesting to see. Not only where the kingdom is today, but where the potential lies, that'll probably be driven primarily by the youth again. So that's my view as a New Yorker.
Yeah, I think it's fascinating. In the United States, you see a lot of government cutbacks on funding the arts, but in places like Saudi Arabia, you see governments heavily supporting it and seeing it as an important part of developing their overall culture and ecosystems. So, does anybody have any questions? Hi.
I'm Ronnie. I'm working with ETH News. And you mentioned that NEOM is not really going to be under the jurisdiction of the kingdom. Can you explain more the relationship between the kingdom's laws and how NEOM operates, and also who will be invited to work and live in NEOM?
Did you hear the question? They were wanting more details in terms of NEOM and how it's going to be outside the jurisdiction, like what that means, and also who's being invited to work and live in NEOM. And I think that's an interesting question, because NEOM is beginning to sign contracts with companies, including STC. So if you could provide more detail.
Yeah, sure. Well, NEOM, it's going to be like country within a country. So it has its jurisdictions, it will have its own laws to be able to thrive, to give it the agility that it requires to achieve its goals and ambitions. Yeah. So when it comes to living there, of course, similar to any other country, we'll have to definitely apply and see how this would work, depending on what kind of either sector or what kind of things that are required in that, city. So there are major factories that are being contracted now to be built there. Obviously, there are many in the news that are becoming and investing in NEOM. So definitely, as part of those projects, anyone can apply to be able to work in NEOM.
And Yasmin knows a lot about it. You've met with the NEOM team.
It's definitely a project that a lot of youth in Saudi Arabia are excited about. And I know that they have big plans. I think that we will be able to see something materialize, I hope, very soon. My understanding is they're trying to incorporate technology of the future, or how it's going to be in the future.
Mm-hmm.
Developing the infrastructure for the technology today. And so we're looking at something really revolutionary and innovative, and mm-hmm. it's going to be really interesting to see how that materializes.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so that's a great question, right? How does a country support and remain agile to facilitate growth, right? How do you get that flexibility? And oftentimes, it's government that prevents this accelerated growth. So I think NEOM is doing a great job in creating that legal framework that allows for a global team to go out and actually work on building the city. So not only will you have a group of international individuals and citizens living there, but also people that are developing the country are keeping that in mind, right? So it's an international team that's building it. I'm not sure in terms of the detail. They're obviously working closely with the current government, but
it'll have its own judiciary.
I'm sorry?
It'll have its own judiciary.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. But the point being then, that regulatory framework is really important to get up to speed. Hopefully that helps.
Thank you.
Hello, check, yeah.
Yeah.
Hi, I have a question for the gentleman from STI. My name
STC.
Is
STC.
STC.
Yeah.
My name is Matthew, and I'm wondering, what are you guys doing with the network level data that your users are generating, their location beacons, what websites they're going to, applications that they're using? Is that information that you're packaging and putting on the blockchain in terms of developing a persona for later use in an advertising scenario? And how do you get around PII compliance, if so?
Can you repeat the last question?
Do you have PII compliance or privacy compliance?
Right? Yeah, yeah.
Because while I'm cool with my information being on the blockchain, I don't want them to be able to trace it back to me. That was kind of why this all started, right? Let's be anonymous but transparent, yeah?
Sure. Yeah? Well, when it comes to data, I mean, as telcos, we do data monetization. There is a recent product that we just released, which is called Slicer, which gives the location data, the demographics, where you can target individuals that you want based on demographics, based on location, etc. We definitely have BI and data scientists within the company that help us develop new applications and services that can be built on top of that. At the moment, it's not built on blockchain, but this is something that definitely in the mind of the product team, how to evolve this product and make it more future-proof, if you will.
Well, especially if you could kind of track what someone is actually seeing, especially what message they're going to expose. So that, for example, wants to find out how long it took someone to buy a product. You can say, yeah, well, we saw the Coke had 6 times and it's on the blockchain based on
I totally agree with you. I mean, just I'd like to take this as a good chance also to mention that within STC we have something called Blue Vault, which is more of a similar to Google, I would say, Store and Apple App Store, where developers can put their applications on top of this platform and it can be sold within Saudi to any, I would say, major, I would small and medium businesses or even government, where at the end of the month it will come as part of their bills. So this will relieve and offload developers from going for the billing and collection and making sure that they go after everyone, just making sure that they focus on their own business. So this might fit if there is any application that can leverage any data, for example, to be published as part of the applications that can mm-hmm. be sold.
Yeah, I mean, I'm just thinking out loud. It sounds like that's entirely our app on It sounds like what you're talking about is like a carrier app that's pre-installed probably on, Android devices. So it's out of the box for everyone.
Okay.
Am I correct in that, or?
I would think the devil's in the details. So I think if we can take it offline, we can have a further discussion. And if anyone is interested, definitely we can join us in that discussion.
All right. Thank you.
Hi, thanks for the talk. I'm Haley. It was great insight into how blockchain can really release power of the and impact.
If you could speak more into the mic.
Yeah, get positive impact on domestic economy. But I was wondering your thoughts on its impact on the international. For example, I think that blockchain has the power to integrate Sharia-compliant products For example, it can facilitate proliferation of Islamic financial products and lower the cost of structuring. So your thoughts on that?
Did you hear the question?
Sure. So the question was, how can
blockchain... Sharia law compliance products?
So Sharia law compliance products, for everyone who may not know, are products that basically fall in line with the religion of Islam to be able to invest within those guidelines. Blockchain technology creates a sense of transparency, which allows or facilitates that that investment opportunity. Things that we get particularly excited about is being able to create financial tools or products that have that level of transparency as well. So Pangea, perfect example, would be you have now ownership in an underlying asset, and you have full disclosure of what that asset produces. You have full disclosure of the expenses related to that asset. Now, if an investor wants to participate and have and they want that level of detail, they'll be able to do that. So similarly for Pangea, you can apply that sort of level of transparency across other equity products, other debt products as well, informing individuals to be able to invest in Sharia compliant products.
I'd like to add also, there's the Islamic Development Fund. They are actually doing something on blockchain at the moment where they want to track if they are funding any, I would say, country or any unit or organization within a country. So blockchain is helping them a lot in understanding where this is, this money is going and to what exactly. Yeah.
Okay. Thank you.
Assalamu alaikum. I have a question, actually. If there is anyone within the audience has great ideas about investing in Saudi, whether it's within your industry or somewhere, some other industry, where should they go? Is there a specific website that you recommend them to reach out and share their great ideas?
Sure. Specific websites that you can reach?
Yeah, is there, like, if they have an idea within this industry or other industry in terms of a startup, where should they go? Is there a specific, like, organization with the Saudi wishing for it, like a startups or help their startups?
Me too.
Did you catch that?
So I think you're asking if you have a startup or you're interested in learning more and you're in the kingdom, resources.
Yes.
So I would say MISC has a number of events.
Yeah, it's just like not a specific industry, maybe some other industry, but they want to start and invest in Saudi. In a specific authority they have to go, or a specific organization that encouraging a startup.
Can you repeat?
We can definitely connect offline.
Yeah.
And I'm happy to share all that information with you.
Okay.
Awesome.
Okay.
Great question.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Hi. I think what the work that you're doing in the Middle East is really exciting, and it's really impressive to see how Consensus is a trailblazer in the region. And I want to ask two things. So you said you've made an in-depth study and consultation with STC in identifying which are the sectors and use cases that you will be working on. Can you share that? And then my second question as well is, how do you envision creating a community that's collaborative and where we can all share best practice, not only as companies that work in the blockchain space and enterprises that are adopting blockchain technologies, but also as countries, from Saudi Arabia to Bahrain to the Emirates to the rest of the Gulf and the Middle East, and that will serve as best practice for emerging markets?
Cool.
That's a good question.
Use cases and how do you foster community, right?
In collaboration.
Yeah.
You want to take that?
Well, yeah, the first one, I mean, maybe Mo just touch point on some of what we have done together. I mean, we had an extensive yet very exciting exercise back home in Riyadh, where we went through, cannot be disclosed at the moment, I would say, kind of use cases. And we are going, we took it from different angles to make sure that we have a good assessment to prioritize the, I mean, the opportunities and the use cases that we have. As part of this exercise, we are going through each account or each vertical and going to see the impact and whether we can really penetrate, whether the customer has that knowledge or not to be able to deliver those kind of services. One of the interesting parts, and to be frank with you, the things that made us work with Consensus is the openness. They are open to work with others. They are, really open to work within a community. And this is what we are trying to build in Saudi. We are trying to build like more of a blockchain kind of environment where people can participate, can share knowledge, and I'll be more than happy to discuss more with you if you want to participate and be part of this.
Can you name the verticals that you've identified that are ready for adoption of blockchain technologies? Obviously, so telecoms is part of it, but I think what should be shared as that STC is much more of a horizontal organization as well, and it's not just the telecoms part. So which ones are the industries that we should all be targeting and supporting in their adoption?
Based on the numbers, there are always the two sectors that pops up, which is financial and logistics. Logistics all the way, whether it's customs, whether it's ports, whether you name it. So those two always pops up as the one of the highest. However, there are some others which has more, which will have more impact. Not necessarily maybe the when it comes to monetary value, but when it comes to impact, they will be more way higher. There is one thing that I just missed to mention, that why STC is working on this, also because we have diverse, subsidiaries within the region. So there is STC in Saudi, we have Viva Bahrain, and we have Viva Kuwait as to start with. So whatever we done in Saudi, we can easily replicate in those countries.
Yeah, okay. So I would definitely agree. I think supply chain logistics are very interesting or interesting vertical or industry that we like. Within that specifically, one of our spokes, Viant, which is led by Tyler, is something that we'll do a deep dive on, naturally finance as well. To answer your question about community, so within Consensus, we have Consensus Labs, which we basically use as a source to identify both internal and external projects as well. And we'll look to create a mirror image of that in Saudi Arabia. So if you would imagine, young group of individuals come together, they have a concept that they want to bring to market, they'll be able to take that concept through our process. Obviously, naturally, we'll also have other infrastructure support too through meetups that we'll probably host. The Dubai team does a great job of facilitating meetups over there. We hope to do the same in the kingdom as well. So creating that community, having that cross-pollination between folks that are at Consensus, at STC, pairing up and being able to help get the on-ramps going, and also kind of moving the community forward collectively. Cool, okay. Thank you.
So we just have a few minutes left. So I think the final question that I have for you guys is, we talked at the very beginning in terms of how Saudi Arabia was a closed society that's now opening itself up economically, and how blockchain helps facilitate that in terms of, to her point, collaboration both within the region and to the world. Like, what are big ways to?
So one thing that I must mention, and I forgot to mention, and I think it fits with your question, is the challenge that we're designing.
Oh, with the bounties team. Yeah.
So when we sat down to come up with use cases using mental health applications on the blockchain, so that's when... to create a challenge that will help developers around the world try to come up with solutions or applications, particularly among youth, because they're the most high-risk community that are affected with mental health. And so we'll be announcing that very soon.
Yeah, so we should all look out for that in Saud. Thank you.
Well, can you just repeat the question again?
Well, in terms of Saudi Arabia was a closed society, and now it's opening itself up, and what that means, and the role of blockchain.
Yeah, so when it comes to Saudi, opening up requires, it's part of the vision, definitely, and where we want to attract more businesses. So the second pillar or the second theme of Vision 2030 is thriving economy. So as part of that, we have to be very, very transparent. And I believe that blockchain can help a lot to make sure that we have something very transparent, secure, scalable, and reliable. So I believe that it has the right fit when it comes to enabling the vision or the realization of Vision 2030.
Yeah. So from my end, I think technology often has an impact on human behavior. And what we're seeing with this technology is an impact on how consumers are behaving or how these new ecosystems or businesses are evolving. So for me, it's particularly exciting to see within Saudi new, you know, sort of business models and ecosystems sort of form through this technology. And, you know, historically, where the kingdom has typically looked at the rest of the world from business models, I think here's an opportunity for them to start from scratch, just like other countries in the, across the world, that can potentially form their own business models or these new ecosystems within various industries. So for me, that's probably exciting in terms of opening up the kingdom through this technology.
Yeah, and I work with Consensus Research, and we're going to be collaborating with Uport and other spokes to do a lot of these experiments in terms of new business models for the first time. So we're excited to experiment in Saudi Arabia. Well, that is all the time that we have. We thank you all for listening, and thank you to our guests. Yasmin and Saud flew in from Riyadh yesterday just to come to this event, so we appreciate them coming.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.